Y ahora vamos a pasar a mirar la perspectiva desde los fabricantes de maquinaria. Y el moderador de esta sesión va a ser Daniel Rodríguez, quien es especialista en agronegocios y mercadeo y líder del proyecto insignia del IICA en competitividad y sustentabilidad de cadenas agrícolas para la seguridad alimentaria en América Latina. En esta mesa van a estar Vanessa Stifler Klaus, Philip de León y Miguel Aburto Melo. Tenemos hasta las 15 horas para cumplir con la tarea de esta perspectiva desde los fabricantes de maquinaria. Gracias, Daniel.
Thank you, Joaquín. Well, I hope you have the good energy of this after the food, you know, to have a very interactive afternoon with us. In this session, as Joaquín mentioned, in the morning we talk about, you know, some general things and about the, you know, the view of the producers. In this session, you know, we will address the perspective of the manufacturers. And you know, the goal here is to be able to share with you on three topics. The first one is related to, you know, what are the, you know, the obstacles that, you know, for them to expand on the region, if there are obstacles, you know, to have an idea of their plans and actions to meet the producer demand, and if it's possible to share with us a little bit about, you know, the smallholders' point of view. And finally, maybe they can share with us, you know, some desirable policies, you know, that they think that it will help increase mechanization in Latin America. As Joaquin mentioned, we have three panelists. First is Vanessa Stifler Klaus is going to talk with us. She's the Director of International Affairs for John Deere. After that, we're going to have Philippe de Leon. He's the Director of Public Affairs and International Business Development for AGCO Corporation. And finally, Miguel Aburto Melo, he's from Oxbow, and he's a representative in Southern America, and he's also CEO of Clearwater SA in Chile. And just, you know, some quick indications. Each one of you is going to have 15 minutes. I will let you know after, you know, before you have to end 2 minutes previously. Please make notes of your questions, and also remember for the ones that are listening from other places that you can send questions by email. We have you can send it to aica.us@iica.int. And finally, you know, what we're going to do is please remember that we are translating, so if you can speak slowly, it will be easier for the translators. And also, in this particular session, we're going to have a couple of videos that we will share, you know, some specific experience from, you know, from some other regions. So in order to start, Vanessa, the floor is yours.
All right.
Thank you. Alfredo, okay.
Ah, there we go. Okay, I can see over there too. It's very good. Thank you very much, and good afternoon, everybody. First panel after lunch is not an easy one. We're tired and had some great lunch and great food. And after some great discussions this morning, I'm reminded by the old expression of everything seems to have been said, but as a colleague of mine would say, but not by me. So now I get to say some of the same things that you all heard this morning about the great opportunities and challenges for agriculture in Latin America. Just a background, I think everybody knows John Deere, but we are the world's largest manufacturer of agricultural equipment. We also make construction and forestry equipment that in many of your countries you've come across, I'm sure. But we've had a 60-plus year presence in Latin America. We have factories in Argentina, Mexico, and Brazil, and we employ about 7,000 or 8,000 people in the region. So it's a very critical region for us there, and we have a vast dealer network across all of Latin America. So I'm pleased to talk a bit about what I see as the opportunities and challenges for us in the region. So I'm an optimist by nature, so I want to take a step back and have everybody reflect on the great developments we've seen in the last decade or so. Since the turn of the century, we've really had unprecedented growth in agriculture and food. High prosperity, yields have increased, acres planted have increased. Just in Latin America alone, in the last 10 years, we've seen an increase of 50+% in soybean acreage and yield of 130+% improvements. And this is a tribute to the ingenuity of farmers around the world to help meet our challenges to feed a growing population. We've also had some notable achievements in global food security by reducing hunger and malnutrition by nearly 30%. So I think we need to first take a step back and recognize the great successes that we've had, despite it now being a challenging time for agriculture. The tailwinds are still there for our business. Urbanization, as we heard earlier, population growth with incomes rising and people wanting different and better diets around the world are still there. So the agricultural sector around the world will be called upon to continue to deliver the great safe and economical food supply that we are doing. And John Deere hopes to help enable that all over the world. But as we'll talk a bit later, we are in a bit of a difficult situation. We're in this transition now of maybe a lower commodity prices coming in, farmers having less opportunity for income as in years past, greater volatility and uncertainty in some of our markets, financial markets are sometimes difficult and constraining the farmer customers, policy developments are sometimes not as consistent as we would like. So here is just a graphic that I think underscores this for all of us. We know the world population will grow dramatically between now and the middle of this century. We know that that population growth will take place largely in Asia and Africa. And why is that relevant for Latin America? Of course, because Latin America can be one of the great exporters to feed that population growth around the world. And the crops and commodities that are grown in Latin America are very well suited to do that with large volumes of protein, whether in the form of soybeans or the animal stock, as well as sugar, wheat, corn that the world is demanding. Now, of course, working for an equipment company, I like to make sure everyone recognizes that not just seeds and not just fertilizer are necessary to make sure that we achieve these goals, but mechanization is essential for farmers of all sizes, not just because of labor availability, which we know when people move to the cities in the rural parts of the country, they're constrained with ability to find good farm workers. And that's important, but it's not the only factor that's driving mechanization. Much more is the need to have timely planting, harvesting, treatment of the plant, of the crops, so that we can ensure that the farmers are making the most value in their field at a given time. Farmers of all sizes are really hard pressed to make sure that they know they're doing exactly the right harvest and exactly the right planting. As we were talking earlier about, 1 day, 2 days in delay of harvesting means a lot of money to the producers around the world. And so mechanization is key to that. When we look at Latin America over the last 50 years, the mechanization rate has actually outpaced the world average. These are a little bit outdated numbers because the World Bank hasn't updated the mechanization outlook that they had in the past as often. But we see that the growth of mechanization in Latin America is very impressive. Between 1960 and 1995, the number of tractors per 100 square kilometers, as we heard earlier, was doubled in the world and tripled in Latin America. Now, we had a rapid period of growth in the 70s that seems to have flattened out a little bit in the 90s, which I think, as we'll look at this next slide, is reflected by the fact that pure numbers of tractors per hectare is maybe not the right value to look at what is happening in mechanization. So we at Deere prefer to use horsepower per hectare because that reflects that as farms consolidate or as operations get more substantial, the tractor size inherently means less tractors or fewer tractors doing the same work as many small tractors. So horsepower per hectare is a more relevant statistic that we like to use. But that also shows that until the middle of 2005 or so, mechanization rate was pretty stable but quite impressive in Latin America. horsepower increases over the last 10 years have jumped about 40% declined compared to the period of 10 years before that. So this in Latin America shows particularly this increase of larger scale machinery coming in. That's not to say there is still not a large volume of small tractors, but the highly productive large scale agriculture, notably in Brazil, Argentina, Chile, that have driven this size conversion. Sorry. So now we'll get to my final slide. I have very few slides because I want to make sure we have discussion. But particularly from the perspective of John Deere over the last several decades, Brazil had been leading this increase in mechanization. Understandably, I think from all of your perspectives, with their great emphasis on farm development and agriculture sector growth. But they've slowed a bit recently. And Argentina historically had some strong growth, but because of challenging government policies, really struggled recently to maintain the level of mechanization that was necessary for the Argentinian farmers. So I think that we see now Brazil playing a little bit of catch up in their ownership of the growth of the mechanization sector in Latin America, but I'm very positive that they will continue this trend in all of the producing countries in the region. And I would say that just one note to wrap up here with, when we look towards 2024 or 2025, 10 years from now, Brazil is targeted to produce 130 million tons of soy, and I just picked one of these of the crops to bring to note. That's 30% or 32% more than they are producing in the year 15-16. So when we think of producing 30% more soybeans in 10 short years in Brazil, and we know that it won't all come from new land coming into operation, a large portion of this growth will be due to the efficiencies and the benefits of mechanization and enhanced inputs. So I'm very optimistic for the region. I use Brazil again just as an example here to illustrate that point, but thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation, for your comments. Yeah. Considering that we have, you know, a couple of minutes Philippe was not here in the morning, I would like to make just a few comments of what happened this morning, so you are aware. When we were discussing in the previous, you know, in the previous sessions, there are, you know, some factors that can help us think a little bit on this session too. And is when we talk about the mechanization in Latin America, we talk about that there is a, you know, low penetration compared to other regions. We also talk that the demand is concentrated in a few countries. Also, you know, that the stock of tractors is old and in many cases obsolete. Also, that right now the machinery is used in most of the time in large scale products. There was an interesting topic also raised by Honduras that mentioned that not always the operators are well trained to use the equipment, and also the limitations of things like, you know, geography, scale, the financial limitations. And also one topic that I think is important is the production seasonality. So with that in mind, you know, I will let you share your opinion with us.
Very well. Thank you very much for having me. It's a pleasure to see you all. Just a brief word about AGCO. AGCO is a large manufacturer of agricultural equipment like John Deere. But the difference is we grew by acquiring...
Excuse me, Philippe. Oh. Looks like there's something wrong and they're not listening to you.
Now it's better? Yes? Puedo hablar español, pero solamente un poquito. Por eso voy a esperar un poquito más y hablar después. So, as I was saying, AGCO is a manufacturer of agricultural equipment, but So we do tractors and combine like John Deere, but we also do equipment to do grain storage. We also do equipment to raise chicken, to do eggs, and to do pork. You probably know us more under our brands like Massey Ferguson, Valtra, Challenger, that are well known. And Valtra is a big player in Brazil, for instance. What I'd like to do, I'd like to go into some of the topics you raised and the questions that I was asked to address today. The first one is, what are the main obstacles to expand our operations? There are multiple obstacles. They can be of three type. I would say, first, geopolitical economic factors, second, regulatory factors, and third, social factors. On the geopolitical economic factors, I would say is that political instability is definitely a problem. What's happening in Brazil is concerning, in Venezuela. What was happening in Argentina was a problem, but now it's changing. The lack of visibility for any investor or manufacturer prevents us from planning, and we can't operate without planning long in advance. So that is a problem. Another issue, which is an economic one, is the variation of fuel price. When there are high fluctuation, that definitely makes the cost of operating equipment a challenge for farmers. The second obstacle is regulatory factors. It depends on each country, but unions and labor law can be a problem. We have nothing against unions and labor laws, but there has to be a balance between protecting the labor force and enabling the companies to operate in a foreign country. Again, a balance can be found. It's not an opposition between the two. It's just finding the right balance so that everybody gains. Another problem that you mentioned is credit availability. So everybody talks about it, but what is the solution? I'd like to address this because I reflect a lot about it. We all have identified the needs of each of your country, but then there's a challenge of accessing the equipment, and I think there has to be better work between the different players. There are the private sector, that's us. You have you and the farmers, that's the user of the equipment, and then you have the finance institution, whether they are international or local, and then you have government, you need support of the government, and then you have local facilitators, meaning organizations that can play a role in bringing everybody together. So I think each country really needs to work with finance provider and say, this is what we need, can you put a program in place so that we can acquire farm equipment. There's always money for infrastructure, for power generation, but when it comes for individual piece of equipment, I think big financial institutions have a hard time putting a system in place. So you have to play a role in telling to those organizations, this is what we need. Because I meet with the World Bank, and I met them recently, they showed a very nice report, but we don't need another report, we need an actionable plan. Now, another regulatory factor that is a problem is environmental regulation. Again, we're not fighting regulation for environment. We all want better laws and better systems. However, it's very important to consult with the private sector so that you can be sure that the law makes sense or can be implemented. Sometimes it takes time for us to adjust our equipment to meet the new standards. We need to work hand in hand again. We're not fighting regulation, but sometimes we need a certain time to make things happen. Sometimes environmental regulation have a high cost, so who's going to bear that cost? That's things to think about. The third factor is the social factor. What will be the that you know can play a role as an obstacle for us to expand? Well, sometimes it's customers' preference and loyalty. You know, I meet a lot of people who are John Deere customers and they're very loyal to the brand because they like it. Then John Deere will see us and people like our Massey Ferguson and Valtra. So it's sometimes hard to transition, you know, a customer to another company, and it's also hard sometimes to make the case to new customers. Loyalty is also very important. You know, customers will rely on services and support packages, and so it's very hard for them to transition to another provider of equipment. Another problem is definitely the lack of skilled workers. This has been identified. What is the solution? Well, it is important that we work together to have skilled workers through vocational training or working with universities so that they create some courses and diplomas that will put on the market people who have the skills we need. I think that is one of the solutions. Complaining about the lack of skilled workers won't do anything. What is the solution? And the solution is to creating those skilled workers, and it takes time, but it doesn't have to take forever. You know, in 1 year, you definitely can bring somebody up to speed to be operational. The second thing I was asked to talk about is the plan and actions to meet the producer's demand for machinery services. I'll try to focus also on smallholders. I think there's definitely a need to increase the horsepower, and there is a need to increase the use of precision farming. Precision farming can be defined as the use of technology that uses GPS systems that enables you to track where your equipment has gone so that it doesn't go twice in the same place, it doesn't put fertilizer again in the same place, it doesn't put seeds in the same place, it reduces waste, it also enable you to optimize the use of land. Let me give you a visual example. Without a GPS, your tractor may go here and then will go here. With GPS, your tractor may go like that, and the amount of space between the two passages of the tractor will be smaller. Well, that can be a significant economy of scale. You definitely can save, you know, or increase the use of your land by 10, 15%, if not more. When it comes to smallholder, there's a lot of talk about the need to consolidate. And it is a dilemma, because when you say you need consolidation of land, people will say, you're going to spoliate smallholder farmers. This is not what we want. And I don't believe that spoliating smallholder farmers is the way to go. We definitely need to put land together. And that may take several generations, but it can also be done by pooling farmers together so that together they're strong enough to purchase equipment. So instead of having 100 farmers with 1 hectare, you have 100 farmers with 100 hectares that together will purchase some equipment and make use of it. And together, they will have the capacity to purchase equipment, to get a loan for a bank that will feel more comfortable to lending to a collective of farmers. So we try to disseminate this message. We try to connect with farmers' organization so that we can see how we can provide equipment. We can't go alone, and this is why it is important we identify those organizations so that we can work with them. Again, the idea is to incorporate all the farmers. The third point I was asked to focus on was what policies do we consider desirable to help increase mechanization levels in the region? Well, I alluded to the fact that we need support to small and medium-sized farmer. That support can be financing, but as I said, help to get organized and to be stronger together. We, the private sector, cannot do it all. Sometimes people say, can you bring your equipment and bring the financing at the same time? Well, okay. Then if we also are asked to, you know, bring the farmers together and have them work together, we just simply cannot. We can help, we can participate, but we cannot be the leader. This is why we count on you to helping us create the environment so that we can all work together. The other point is, it's not just about having the right policy in place, but it is about honoring and respecting them. You know, I deal with the world. I'm lucky and unfortunate. I'm very busy. But every country that comes to me say, come, you're welcome. We have a free economic zone. We have a special agricultural zone. And but at the end, every country offers the same thing. What matters is that over time, those benefits remain, that the promises made are kept. This is why it is important that the system be transparent, the way you give land away or right to use land or give, you know, have a tender for the purchase of equipment, so that when the next government comes in place, when you have a election, the new government doesn't feel that they have to reassess everything and stop everything until they judge whether the process was fair or needs to be reviewed. I think we need, you know, predictability over time and not have the word of the previous government changing, because this is debilitating for us, but also for our customers. I can say a lot more, but ultimately what I try to do is I try to tell people, stop generating reports about what the problems are, what are the opportunities. I think by now we know them, okay? What we need to do is to do the hard part. You know, talking is fun. It's just working on identifying the sources of financing, convincing the finance provider to put a solution in place so that we can all use it. Whether my company, John Deere, your company, it has to be available for all. And but we need your voice as well. I keep talking to multilateral institution, and they say, okay, we'll follow up with you, and then they don't follow up. Or sometimes they will say, well, this is not what the government asks us for. You know, those governments, they tell us what they want. But sometimes you and your government ask for what happened before. Like if you see that the World Bank or the Inter-American Development Bank has provided a grant for irrigation, you're going to ask for irrigation. Some will have asked for, you know, power generation, and that's what will happen. But you need to think outside the box and say, we also need support for the purchase of smaller equipment, tractors, combine, grain storage, because grain storage addresses the issue of post-harvest loss and waste, and equipment to raise chicken, pork, and eggs, especially chicken and egg, because, you know, one egg a day in the life of a child during the first 1,000 days can prevent stunting and a lot of other health-related problems. So you need to convey that message, because if we, a manufacturer of equipment who sells for a profit, says that, they will think all they want to do is make money. Of course we want to make money. But the fact is that our solutions are the solutions that are needed. So we also need you to say, we do need you to support the private sector to work in our country. So those are the three points I wanted to address on a practical point, so that we can move towards getting some solutions fast, not in 10 years. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Philippe, and exactly 15 minutes too. So now we're moving to the next one. Miguel, adelante. Mm-hmm.
Buenas tardes. Gracias por la invitación. Una pequeña introducción. Llevo en este ámbito y terminé en una mezcla entre lo que me tocaba hacer desde la plantación de los cultivos hasta hoy, en que estoy viendo el cómo resuelvo pronto con lo que se está cosechando. Y nuestro principal desafío siempre como país, desde Chile, ha sido enviémoslo lo antes posible. Y eso significa estrategia. Bien, como país con muchas ganas de estar en pleno desarrollo, hemos buscado diferentes formas de solucionar nuestra situación, nuestro contexto agrícola. Y en ocasiones es posible encontrarse con este tipo de imágenes en la carretera. Este es un tractor que lleva plantas de tomate y el implemento que lleva y el que está soportando las bandejas de plantitas de tomate es la transplantadora. ¿Cómo hago para cambiar? ¿Cómo cambio la diapositiva? Ok. Respecto de mecanización y servicios, que es lo que nos convoca, después de haber vivido muchos inconvenientes, llegamos a una conclusión con un grupo de colegas en Chile. Un problema sin solución no es problema, un problema con solución no es problema. Y desde ahí parto con lo que les quiero comentar. ¿Cuáles son los conceptos ineludibles? No podemos perder desde el inicio, desde solo pensar en hacer algo en términos agrícolas, es la oportunidad. Y lo segundo que nos está ocurriendo en términos prácticos es que, por diferentes motivos, hay una disminución de la oferta laboral. ¿Cómo participa Oxbo en esto? Oxbo nace hace 60 años buscando soluciones en el estado de Wisconsin, y buscando soluciones para qué, básicamente para solucionar el problema de manos, que era la cosecha de frijoles verdes, porotos verdes, chauchas, que tenía que ser manual. Así es como nace, y hoy, después de una estrecha vinculación con productores, hemos integrado lo que son otros conceptos, que son servicios y capacitación. Oxbow, la empresa, significa yunta, y yunta parece que lo conocemos todos, es tiro, es fuerza. Tenía mucho sentido lo que comentaban mis colegas acá, en términos de lo importante son los caballos de fuerza, los horsepower. A nosotros nos tocó vivir, y nos tocó vivir hace menos de 10 años, la novedad de incorporar un tractor de 120 HP al sistema. ¿Por qué? Porque estábamos acostumbrados a no más allá de 90, 95 HP. Bien, Oxbow, después de estos 60 años de funcionamiento, y partiendo con cosechadoras de porotos verdes, cosechadoras de maíz dulce para fresco, cosechadoras de berries hoy, ha ido evolucionando y ha ido buscando cómo llegar al cliente y a clientes específicos, terminando la empresa en un nicho, buscando nichos. Y es que hemos derivado así a diferentes cultivos que ni siquiera hemos pensado en cosechar. Terminamos con equipos de cosecha de tiro tractor, que no era de ahí veníamos hace 60 años atrás, y hoy, por diferentes motivos, estamos volviendo a eso. Y lo otro es que estamos ofreciendo diferentes dimensiones para distintos tipos de clientes. Esta es una foto en que un productor le está presentando una situación a un representante de Oxbow, y nos dice: necesitamos cosechar con este grado de pendiente. Y nos pedían que cosecháramos con un 20% de pendiente. Y nos pedían que cosecháramos en esta dirección y en esta dirección. Eso significa que el equipo tiene que tener estabilidad en los dos ejes, o la estabilidad del equipo entero. Bueno, nos plantean el desafío, y hoy día estamos conversando con ellos para entregarles la solución, resolver el problema, atender su necesidad. Y esto en muchos cultivos. Hoy día en Chile estamos con mecanización de al menos 10 cultivos en esta línea. Otra foto del panorama. Aquí esta es una zona en la que se producen olivos cultivados en alta densidad, para los cuales cambia completamente la forma de hacer el cultivo, que es el otro mensaje que les quiero entregar. Cuando estamos mecanizando, tenemos que pensar desde antes de la siembra o desde antes de la plantación, qué es realmente lo que necesitamos. ¿Es posible para usted imaginarse olivos de 3 metros y de no más allá de 1.5 metros de ancho y que estén entregando una producción que permita sustentar y rentabilizar el negocio? En Chile se está dando y hoy día estamos llegando a 30.000 hectáreas en producción de olivos, con 10.000 a 12.000 que van a entrar en producción pronto. Sigo insistiendo en oportunidad. Y la oportunidad, y llevado a lo que es mecanización, termina en volumen. Yo tengo un potencial productivo. En la medida en que no soy capaz de tomarlo en un momento, mi potencial va disminuyendo y mi techo va cayendo. En precios ocurre exactamente lo igual, es lo mismo. En calidad, si no lo hago en el momento oportuno, la voy a perder y mi precio va a cambiar. Disminuye mi rentabilidad y sale y se van complicando los diferentes conceptos que estamos manejando acá. Me colgué de una foto de un cultivo de café y me colgué de una foto de una plantación de frutillas. Son cultivos de alta demanda y vamos a seguir teniendo problemas. ¿Por qué? Porque el tipo de trabajo que nos está pidiendo este tipo de negocios requiere de mucho esfuerzo. Son los desafíos para seguir mecanizando. Hoy día no existe, nosotros no estamos manejando en Sudamérica la transplantadora de frutillas. No lo estamos manejando. ¿Qué es lo que está haciendo Oxbow? ¿Y qué es lo que estamos buscando con la mecanización? Dar respuesta a demandas, y demandas muy específicas. Por ejemplo, Japón quiere arándanos, pero quiere arándanos de un calibre específico. No le interesa un calibre menor al que ellos quieren y que está relacionado con el contenido de azúcar. Hoy, por ejemplo, y es el tipo de demanda internacional, edamame, si es que conozco, es la palabra japonesa para consumir un frijol característico de ellos. Hoy nosotros recibimos interesados desde Argentina en Chile para ocupar la misma máquina que usamos para cosechar el frijol, el porto verde, y que es factible usarlo en edamame. Oxbow no está pensando en edamame cuando está diseñando la máquina, pero es capaz de flexibilizar y ver cuáles pueden ser las regulaciones o los pequeños cambios para que esté apto para lo que se requiere. Lo mismo pasa con los pedidos de Europa en términos de pasas, cosecha de pasas mecánicas. Sí, es la misma máquina que puede cosechar aceituna o la misma máquina que puede cosechar uva. Tipos de grano en industria cafetera, o, por ejemplo, recibimos intereses. ¿Necesita traducción? ¿Estoy hablando muy rápido? En Perú, por ejemplo, recibimos una muestra de interés para cosechar stevia. Nos dan las condiciones, hacemos la visita y después de entender lo que ellos querían realmente y lo que querían solucionar, el equipo que podía servirles era una mezcla de dos equipos, uno para cosechar espinaca y otro para cosechar poroto verde. Es factible implementar. ¿Sabe qué pasa? Es que el cultivo lo hacemos en la zona de mucha lluvia y nuestro problema principal es la tracción. ¿De acuerdo? Tenemos un posi traction que les sirve y puede tener tracción en terrenos con lluvia. Bueno, en Chile, frutos secos y otros. Esta es una plantación de frambuesas orgánica y este es el desafío que nos pone el productor. ¿Por qué? Porque la frambuesa orgánica, si él la puede congelar, el valor que obtiene es mucho mejor que el fresco, es mucho mejor que cualquier otro producto. Y es capaz de tener rentabilidades de sobre $10.000 por hectárea. ¿Quiere mecanizar? Absolutamente. ¿Por qué? Porque no puede sacar 20.000 kilos por hectárea a mano. Formax, ahí esta foto y lo blanco es lo simpático y cómo vamos integrando diferentes cosas. Ahí se está usando un molido de lupino que se produce en otra región de Chile para que es capaz de absorber el nitrógeno. Bien, nuestra realidad agrícola. Los productores tradicionales presentan dificultades para los cambios. Las van a seguir presentando. Conceptos que tenemos que manejar si es que queremos seguir impulsando esto. Los productores no pueden convertirse en mecánicos. No son operadores. Tienen que ser excelentes productores agrícolas. Saber lo más que puedan del cultivo. No gastar su tiempo en un tractor o en una máquina. Para eso debiesen haber otras personas. ¿Qué es lo que estoy diciendo? Que hay que planificar y de acuerdo a lo que queremos hacer. Los productores nuevos tienen una nueva visión del negocio. Quieren, y cuando les digo productores nuevos, hay productores nuevos de 2 hectáreas, de 5 hectáreas, de 6 hectáreas. Un productor con 6 hectáreas, con mora cultivada, puede financiar muchos de su trabajo. ¿Es un pequeño productor? Sí. Pero también hay productores de 50 hectáreas. ¿Son equipos iguales? No, podemos ajustar a las dimensiones de cada persona, de cada productor. Tipos de huerto. Tipos de huerto. ¿Cómo manejar los espacios reducidos? ¿Cómo justificar la inversión? Esos son los desafíos que estamos viendo. ¿Cuáles son las consideraciones para lo que es la mecanización? Es un trabajo estacional. ¿Cuál es el problema que hay que enfrentar? La subutilización. ¿Cuáles son los otros? Técnicos capacitados. Hay que tenerlo. Y en diferentes países y por países. Falta servicio expedito en terreno, de todas maneras. Hay una urgente necesidad de un mayor desarrollo de prestadores, por supuesto. Necesitamos más prestadores de servicio. ¿Cuáles son los desafíos? Y aquí tiene mucho que ver con qué están haciendo nuestros jóvenes. ¿Qué les ofrecemos? ¿Cómo evitamos la migración? ¿Cómo hacerlos partícipes del negocio? Estoy convencido, y por eso es que hago clases en la universidad, y estoy conociendo a la generación que tiene 20 años. Necesitamos ampliarles su espacio de confort. Y su espacio de confort parte, como lo decían anteriormente, por el teléfono. Y hay muchas aplicaciones que ellos pueden aprender a usar y ser partícipes del negocio. De este negocio en el que podemos mecanizar. Lo otro, y que estoy convencido, es que a los mismos jóvenes les podemos ofrecer movilidad internacional. En base a lo que ellos aprendan, pueden ir desplazándose. ¿Por qué? Porque en términos de cosecha, son trabajos estacionales. Pueden ir desplazándose. Hay muchos jóvenes que quieren conocer un poco más allá de la frontera que están viviendo. Tecnología, de todas maneras, nos permite aumentar. Ideas. A esta señora se le ocurrió desgranar el choclo. Y lo vende a 10 veces el valor del producto en el mercado. A 10 veces. Y lo entrega en un vaso. Y uno puede elegir qué condimento aplica. Y les muestro en la foto a la izquierda un baby choclo. Son comestibles. Es la misma planta. Y 10 veces el valor que tiene para el mercado fresco. Ideas, de todas maneras. Necesidades. Hay un proyecto, 5.000 hectáreas de lupino en Chile, y nuestro problema es cómo limpiamos el grano. Siguen habiendo más necesidades. Proyecciones a futuro, retos y necesidades silentes, factores de éxito, eso es lo que nos mueve. Integrando el mejoramiento genético, implementando los sistemas de riego, usando aplicaciones tecnológicas, nosotros, y como ejemplo, les podemos decir, logramos dejarle de utilidad neta a pequeños productores $1,000 por hectárea, por cultivo. Si ellos lograban compatibilizar el hacer 2 cultivos en el año, eran $2,000 por hectárea. ¿Productores de qué superficie? 5, 6 hectáreas, con cosecha mecánica. Hoy día, en la agroindustria en Chile, es factible trabajar 10.000 hectáreas bajo completa mecanización. El potencial, 50.000 hectáreas sin ningún problema. Así es como yo veo la mecanización. Es factible.
Perfecto.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias. Bueno, sin duda, mucha puntualidad con el, con los tiempos. And now we're gonna show you the first of the videos. This is a video from India, yeah, and the idea is to. Okay. Perfect. You know, it's to, you know, to share on a way of using machinery in an accessible, affordable, and professional way. So, please, could you please show the first of the videos? Mm-hmm.
What is the one thing that is most important for the prosperity of Indian farmers? Yes, they need land, irrigation, seeds, fertilizers, but most importantly, they need tractors and farming equipment. That's because in India, the number of farmers is much more compared to the number of tractors. Not every farmer, especially the smaller ones, can afford a tractor. Most farmers are often left worrying how and where to arrange a tractor from. They end up asking for favors, requesting acquaintances, facing discrimination, and waiting endlessly for their turn. Even after all this waiting, there is no guarantee on the quality of implements or the work. At times, they don't manage to get a tractor at all. We believe we can change this by revolutionizing how farming is done in India. Presenting Tringo, a revolutionary tractor renting business that aims to empower every farmer in India. For the first time ever, when a farmer needs a tractor or farm equipment, he can simply call and place his order. He will get a good quality tractor along with the desired implement and a professional driver too, without any conditions or questions asked. What's more, he can even order it using the Tringo app. By harnessing the power of technology and a strong franchisee network, Tringo will revolutionize the business of tractors and farm equipment on rent, creating business opportunities and at the same time make farm mechanization easily accessible, affordable, and reachable. With Tringo, you have the opportunity to usher in a new era in Indian agriculture and help our farmers work with their head held high. Join us and bring happiness in the lives of Indian farmers like never before. To become a franchisee today, log on to tringo.com or call 1-800-266-2668.
Perfect. And now we're gonna see the second video. This is an experience from Africa, and as they kind of call themselves, you know, it's, they say that they're the Uber of tractors, and it's a very interesting because we're talking about really small tractors. Please go ahead.
Coming out of college, I looked at what jobs paid the most, so I started my career in investment banking.
Alfredo,
I found myself losing passion for the work, and that's when I decided maybe it was time for a change. Nigeria has one of the largest inventories of uncultivated farmland on earth. The majority of the poor earn their income on the farm, so I knew that's where I needed to meet them. Farmers don't have the labor they need or the machinery to fully cultivate this land. I started with collaborative consumption and the idea that a tractor is expensive and is necessary to make farmers productive. So if farmers have access to a tractor, that's as good as owning one. This is why I started Hello Tractor. We began developing a low-cost, user-friendly, technology-enabled tractor. When farmers need tractor services, they simply send a text message. We connect that request for tractor service with the nearest smart tractor operator, and in a short period of time, the smart tractor arrives and provides a service that's 40 times more efficient and one-third the cost of manual labor. You can think of it like Uber for tractors. We designed a mobile app that allows smart tractor owners to view their machines remotely. They can assign operators to tractors, and they can see a full record of what their smart tractor did in the field. Despite Nigeria being the largest economy in sub-Saharan Africa, rural communities are suffering. The agriculture comes with so many risks and challenges. Technology can fill that gap. Ultimately, we're creating a model that can scale and sustain itself and reach, in my estimation, the entire continent.
You know, the CEO of the company was kind enough, you know, to give us his opinion on the three topics that we are addressing today. So he will share a short video of 2 minutes with, you know, with his view of what we're talking right now. Mm-hmm. Let's see if we can fix it. If not, we'll go. Well, we'll leave it for later. We'll send you the link so they can. Well, so with this, we now move to the session of, you know, of questions and some comments about what we have. Speak in this session. So I would like to invite you to address your questions in the center of the room. Mm-hmm.
Sí, mi pregunta va relacionada con el tema de, no estoy seguro si el financiamiento, creo que fue Philippe que mencionó el tema del financiamiento. Y no sé cómo lo ven ustedes, si es posible. Mi idea muy simple es la siguiente. ¿Por qué es que la mecanización no se paga sola? O sea, voy a poner un ejemplo tonto. Un abogado, cuando uno le dice, mira, tomo tu caso, y si gano el caso, me llevo el 50% de las ganancias del caso, y se pagó, el abogado se cobra solo, ¿no? Lo que estamos diciendo aquí es que la mecanización y el equipamiento sube los yields y ahí se paga, digamos, teóricamente, en principio uno podría de ahí cobrarse. Creo que algunas empresas aquí en Estados Unidos ya están empezando en Precision Agriculture, dicen, ayudamos al productor, te subimos los yields y nosotros nos cobramos el 50% o el 70% del incremento de esa productividad y todo es un sistema en que todos pagan. Mi pregunta es si ven la posibilidad o esta idea de cómo hacer que la maquinaria se pague sola con el incremento de la productividad, de los yields. Entiendo que, claro, no solamente es maquinaria, sino que el incremento de la productividad seguramente está relacionado a muchos otros factores. Pero lo dejo como inquietud, si es que ven la posibilidad de algún sistema que vaya en esa dirección.
Thank you. I think that's a very interesting suggestion. Oh, you wanted to? Oh. Did you want to?
Okay. Okay.
Soy Enrique Erlatz, pertenezco a la Cámara Uruguaya de Servicio Agropecuario de Uruguay. La pregunta mía, más que nada, se la quiero hacer a los fabricantes, bueno, por supuesto. ¿Cómo ven ustedes en el presente y cómo en el futuro a los a las empresas netamente prestadoras de servicio o contratistas, como le quieran? ¿En qué grado lo ven en el negocio para ustedes? Si son clientes más potenciales, la pregunta es si lo ven que el negocio de los contratistas puede seguir en alza o se va a estabilizar. Me interesa saber la óptica de ustedes, nada más. Esa es la pregunta.
Eh,
Yo quisiera preguntarle sobre todo a Philip y a Vanessa, cuando uno ve sus exposiciones y ve la de Miguel Ángel, uno ve como dos orientaciones de soluciones. La gran maquinaria, la maquinaria muy especializada, muy grande, muy robusta para producciones a escala muy grandes, y otra es el aporte de soluciones más acomodadas a las necesidades productivas, como lo que plantea Miguel Ángel, soluciones muy claras, muy concretas. Pero cuando uno mira a estas grandes empresas, uno le preguntaría a Philip y a Vanessa si ustedes verdaderamente tienen como parte de sus desarrollos de investigación para producción de maquinaria, líneas que puedan adaptarse a ese contexto de agricultura latinoamericana, donde hay muchos espacios que no son de grandes áreas arables, grandes áreas productivas, sino que requieren de una innovación, digamos, en materia de equipos o de ayudas para la producción. ¿Qué hay en eso? Porque la señal de las grandes compañías muy posicionadas en el mundo es muy interesante desde la perspectiva de la producción agrícola, a ver qué hay para ese tipo de producciones de menor escala como solución. ¿Existe algo de eso o definitivamente las grandes compañías pues tienen su negocio consolidado y no mirarían esas perspectivas?
Sí. Si les parece, respondemos las primeras tres preguntas y luego nos movemos al segundo, sí, segundo grupo. Mm-hmm. I think, Vanessa, you were trying to answer the first one.
Okay. Yeah. All right, I think I got some notes here of some ideas from my perspective. But I think, just to go in the order that you asked, on the technology financing itself concept, you noted correctly that there are certain aspects of the technology that is already starting to be marketed that way, precision agriculture specifically. When we see that in Europe and the United States and around the world, where in very productive precision agriculture applications, the cost of the increased use of technology is marketed as a way to pay for itself with the yield gains. You also noted, though, the concern with just looking at the equipment is there has to be a positive ecosystem for the equipment to be able to pay for itself with the yields that it increases. Infrastructure is a big one that everyone mentioned, of course. Post-harvest handling of the materials, access to markets, whether it's internationally or locally. And so I think that in situations where there is a good ecosystem, that we are much closer to being able to start quantifying the value of the mechanization to determine what the financial benefit could be. On some of the questions about different approaches to machinery, whether large or small, I think that at least from John Deere's perspective, we welcome all sizes and opportunities for the farmers, and we don't say you have to be big, or you know, go big or go home, as you say in English. We don't have that approach to our farmer customers, and we do work around the world with customers that are tailoring some products for different uses. Miguel mentioned some examples of where people are very innovative. They see a product being used or developed for one type of crop or production system, and they use it in other areas. And we like to interact with those agripreneurs or those emerging entrepreneurs that are thinking about how to do that. And then finally, I think that brings me to my thoughts on the topics of service providers and agricultural contractors. There too, we don't at all shy away from that. Rather, we welcome it with open arms. We have many, many contracting customers across Africa, from the much smaller scale operations all the way to very, very large contracting customers in the US and Canada and in Europe that provide services that otherwise the community cannot do in an economical fashion. So we tailor a lot of our technology and information management systems specifically for those contracting operators. So, and technology is an easy one to have for all areas of size. You know, the mobile technology, like we saw in the Hello Tractor video, that those are things that big manufacturers like Deere are also developing and deploying to help customers of all sizes to use technology to manage their fleets and manage their service.
On the AGCO side, for the first question, if about the equipment paying for itself, well, most definitely yes. The equipment will increase production yields and productivity to a level that should be sufficient to reimburse the equipment. I mean, there's no doubt about it. This is why we need the banks and organizations to put the financing so that the farmers can acquire the equipment so that they can produce enough to reimburse. That's really critical. On the issue of service providers, you have two types of service providers. You have what you have seen, organizations that will make equipment available. That's the type of service provider. So yes, we will see more and more of those. The concept of leasing is gaining momentum. Timeshare, a bit like Uber, you know, this system here we have of cars, in private individuals just make themselves available and you order them on your phone. We're definitely going to see a major transformation in agriculture where before you sell an equipment and that's it, but now you add on value services, which is services where we help with the software, we sell additional software to go with it, or we provide consulting services. So to answer your question, the services will go not just beyond provider of equipment that buy equipment from us and then make it available, but also all the services that go around in helping the farmer. On the third question about solutions tailored to the needs, we our approach is not, this is what we have, take it or leave it. Our approach is more, what is it that you want? And we will try to bring it to you. So we are trying to adapt our solutions. We have, for instance, announced in Africa, but it's a solution that can be adapted somewhere else, something that we call the farm in the box, which consists of a tractor and five implements for a given price. The advantage of it is that it's all in one solution, meaning that the implements will work with the tractors, because sometimes you buy a tractor here, you buy an implement here, and it's the wrong, and it either breaks the tractor or it breaks the implement, so it's all in one. We're also a global company, so we will also make sure that we can offer our equipment at the right price, and the right price means that we may need to ship from India, from China, from Brazil. It really varies, so we try to adapt. So we're not dismissing any country or anyone. Plus, we need to adapt also. I mean, you always have those incredible images of farming in Brazil with, you know, 10 harvesters going, but you know, in countries you have geography and topography, and you can't harvest on a 20 degree slope, so we need to adjust our equipment to address that need, and it's sometimes building smaller equipment. So we're not dismissing anybody. And let me finish by one example. I once asked an American manufacturer of cars on why they had lost ground, or why the French had lost ground in Africa and in many other markets, as opposed to Toyota, and the answer was very interesting. It's that unlike the French and American manufacturers, did not dismiss any small markets. They went after every single market, and this is why Toyota now is all over in every single country, because they did not dismiss small markets. So the lesson is the same for us in agriculture. We are not dismissing any market, and we will consider them. And sometime a small market may be better than a big market, because the legislation, the financing, and everything is more aligned than in a big market. And very last thing, like Nigeria in Africa is always considered like big country, big population. Well, yeah, but try working in Nigeria. The fact is, at the end, you may be better off working in a smaller country where things are easier. So my conclusion is, we will work with everyone if people are ready to work with us, private sector and government. Thank you.
Respecto a la pregunta de si los equipos se financian, la experiencia que tenemos en Chile es que sí, se financian.
Y la experiencia que tenemos específicamente con maquinaria Oxbow es que podemos decir que hay equipos que tienen 20 años y siguen operativos. Respecto de la consulta del colega uruguayo, es importante la participación de los prestadores de servicios. Y es importante porque nos permite entregar un mejor servicio. Es importante en la medida que consideren la calidad de lo que estamos buscando. Es importante que consideren que el valor de lo que van a obtener ustedes tiene que ver con la calidad, el volumen y lo que perseguimos. Estamos trabajando con alimentos y como prestadores de servicio el principal desafío es calidad y oportunidad. Es factible. Respecto de las necesidades, hay necesidades silentes y como Latinoamérica tenemos muchas necesidades que no somos capaces de expresar. En la medida en que la comunicación fluya hacia las industrias que fabrican equipos y que tienen equipos de ingenieros pensando en soluciones, se pueden entregar respuesta a esas inquietudes. El financiamiento para este tipo de empresas es difícil conseguirlo y creo que en general, en lo que estamos conversando, necesitamos trabajar con un fondo rápido porque estamos invirtiendo. No, a diferencia de, y tenemos diferencia entre nosotros como empresas, los que estamos aquí en la mesa, se van a encontrar con empresas que pueden entregar soluciones, pero que no tienen los mismos recursos. John Deere tiene presencia mundial, Oxbow tiene presencia mundial. Pero yo si voy a un evento, yo tengo que comprar el gorro John Deere. Si me presento yo, tengo que regalarlo. Son potenciales que nosotros tenemos que ir viendo cómo buscamos. ¿En qué sentido? En que la industria que fabrica maquinaria tiene que ser capaz de sobrevivir por sí sola. Por sí sola. Gracias.
Buenas tardes. Ricardo Garbers, de la Federación Argentina de Contratistas de Máquinas Agrícolas. En tecnificación y en los índices de eficiencia, Argentina se parece a Estados Unidos y a Canadá y simultáneamente a Bangladesh. Por adopción de tecnología a Estados Unidos y a Canadá y por cantidad de tractores que tiene, más se parece a Bangladesh que a Estados Unidos y a Canadá. Eso habla de una superpoblación. La cantidad de tractores por hectárea no es un índice de eficiencia. Yo calculo que es un índice de ineficiencia. Cuanto más tractores por hectárea tengamos, más costoso van a ser esos granos. O ese forraje o ese producto hortícola. La pregunta es, ¿no es mejor empezar a calcular cuánto HP hay por tonelada producida o cuánto es el capital inmovilizado por tonelada producida? La pregunta básicamente va para ACCO y para John Deere. Gracias.
Buenas tardes. Una pregunta sencilla para John Deere. ¿Cuáles son los planes para los próximos 5 años de John Deere Financial?
Another question? No? Okay. Philip, maybe this time you can go first. Okay, there's another one.
Thanks. I was just wondering, related to the question just prior, whether you see any yet unexploited opportunities on the cost of production and assembly of some of this equipment. I know that producing this equipment is a large capital investment and it is not inexpensive. It's also not inexpensive to ship the machinery. So I'm wondering, looking at Latin America specifically, whether there are some areas yet unexploited to reduce the cost of production. And I wouldn't exclude from that questions about any sort of regulatory licensing, importing prices that you face that you think governments really need to take a closer look at to bring down the cost of production and therefore make the accessibility to smallholder farmers a bit better.
On the question of horsepower per ton, it's an interesting question. I know the mining industry is now selling his equipment or going towards saying this piece of equipment will provide, will enable you to mine like this amount of ton. I think there's definitely conversation in the agricultural industry to see if our message should be a bit different and say this is the yield we promise or say you will generate. So things are changing and adapting, and you will see in the coming years more and more conversation on this topic. On the issue of reducing the cost of production, again, there's always this concept, this idea that if you manufacture locally, you're going to reduce cost. As one of our presidential candidates would say, I would say, wrong. it can be true, but not always, because in order to manufacture successfully in a country, you need volumes and large volumes. You also need a network of suppliers that does not necessarily exist. You need foundries that can produce the metal you need, and it doesn't always exist. If you have foundry, you need reliable, predictable access to electricity that is not necessarily available in the volume we need. So I often push back on the issue of localization and say, what is more important for your government and your country? Is it to try to manufacture locally to create maybe 1,000 jobs? Or is it more important for you to bring the equipment that your farmer needs and enable tens or hundreds of thousands of farmers to not only increase production, but, you know, get out of subsistence farming to profit farming, and to also enable the countries to become net exporter instead of only self-sufficient and so on. I'd like to add one thing. The last question was asked by Russ Webster, who works for the organization CNFA, which is Cultivating New Frontier in Africa. ACCO works with CNFA in Africa, and CNFA had created a system that they are developing of what they call Farm Service Center, which is where farmers go to get help, to get seeds, fertilizers, veterinary products, and we're working with them on trying to also offer a mechanization system. So as this venue is also for you to network with people, I would suggest you also talk to Russ to see about what's being done in Latin America, because this comes back to the questions that were asked earlier about services. This is also a way for outside organizations that buy our equipment, but then let other people use it. I think we're going to see this happen more and more. Thank you.
I will just concur with all that was said about localization and local manufacturing. I think we are exactly on the same page there, Philip. On the question specifically about John Deere Bank and John Deere financing, if you've followed our financing operations over the last couple of years, you'll see that we are conscientiously and regularly growing into new markets with that operation. The aim for John Deere Finance is to provide the suite of financial services for our customers to help enable them to buy our equipment around the world. So logically, we've started in those places where we had the largest number of customers and the largest need, and as we expand around the world, we are opening operations in secondary markets at quite a rapid speed, and tailoring the financial offerings to that market. So in some cases, it might be Banco John Deere or John Deere Bank that is providing the financial services, but oftentimes we are also working with a local bank in the community that can help deliver the products more quickly and more cheaply to the customers. I'm happy to talk also offline with you if you'd like.
Okay, good. Since we still have a couple of minutes, I think they fixed the video. So, Alfredo, could you help us with the video?
Yep. Hello, everyone. I want to talk briefly about Hello Tractor, our incentive structures, the impact that we seek, and also some of the constraints to growing our business. First of all, we tried to structure the business in such a way that all stakeholders benefit financially from engaging. Farmers are able to plant faster and save money. Tractor owners actually obviously make money from providing tractor services. Banks get a pretty healthy interest rate, and our maintenance and repair technicians earn income from providing repair services to the tractors in the field. So there's a financial incentive in place for all of these stakeholders engaged in the platform. Some of the biggest challenges or constraints to growing the business, I would say, is probably on the financing front. Banks are still very uncomfortable lending in agriculture. We designed a program that avoids many of the covariate risks associated with lending in agriculture. Extreme weather events, market and price volatility for the underlying commodities, pests, disease. We avoided these risks by designing a platform that addresses the labor input. And this is something that's not necessarily reliant on harvest when the farmer makes that purchase decision. And then lastly, for impact, we look at the household level, income generated by having access to tractor services. And then we also look at how households change their investment decisions when they save money by accessing tractor services. So are they purchasing more value-added inputs, fertilizer, seeds, or are they doing other important things like sending their kids to school? So that's how we look at impact. We also look at how much we measure very closely, how much the tractor owners are making, and obviously we want to make sure all those loans are performing so the banks remain engaged. So that's how we look at impact. I'm glad you all have taken some time to hear the Hello Tractor story, and I hope to be in touch. Thank you.
Well, now for some closing remarks. I think one of the good panels, the good thing about the panel is that we started with a really, positive note. There's a huge opportunity for agriculture in Latin America, and mechanization is a really important part to be able to, to conquer those opportunities. Regarding the challenges, we talk about basically four types of challenges. One related to markets and price volatility. Excuse me, the transition to lower commodity prices, but also about some geopolitic problems like instability in some countries, economic problems like the fuel cost, regulatory problems and challenges we mentioned, and social factors regarding to the inclusion of youth and also the customer preferences. Regarding the the intention of adapt to to producers' demand, I think there's a will and there's a need to do that in every single company. And regarding the policy, in a way, first the policy needs to be able to support producers in things as financing, organizing them, and also not only developing the policy but implementing it is really important, and be sure that that policy will remain on for the long run with a very transparent system. And probably I like to finish with two important things. Is that it was mentioned that there's a need to partner between private sector, governments, and different actors to be able to really improve productivity and achieve some of the goals. And also probably the most important that is we have to, you know, put things into action. And I really hope that, you know, this is a kickstart for, you know, for the months to come, you know, and that we are all together. And I really appreciate your comments and your thoughts. And thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to do two more comments. In order to have successful mechanization, we need to think about the following. If you're going to purchase some equipment and spend $100, maybe you should devote 80% to that purchase and 20% is set aside for maintenance, spare part, and so on. A big mistake is people spend all their money on the equipment and never thought of what happens if a part breaks or something happens. I mean, we, as American manufacturers, provide warranty and so on, but, you know, over the lifetime of our equipment, which lasts a long time because we produce quality, you will need spare parts. You need to think about it. A lot of other countries sell equipment, and then when it breaks, you're left with pilfering the remaining ones that still work to put, you know, to have at least a few pieces working together. The other comment I want to make is, it's very nice to talk about increasing production and productivity, but what about storage? A lot of people don't think about, well, I'm going to increase production and productivity. Well, what about storage? There's a lot of waste after the harvest because there is improper storage. So maybe my comment should be, you should not allocate 80%, but maybe 60%, and also think about storage solution, because otherwise it's wasted. And a lot of governments and people forget that component, but it is a critical one. Proper storage is critical. Thank you.
Muchísimas gracias a este excelente panel. Tal vez para tratar de conectar algunos temas con lo que viene para la tarde, un tema que ha sido recurrente en la mañana y en la tarde es este movimiento cíclico de la demanda de maquinaria o de mecanización en la agricultura correlacionado con el movimiento cíclico de los precios. Es bien interesante como pregunta para tal vez el último panel de política de cómo romper estos ciclos en agricultura, porque si no hay inversión en agricultura en momentos de precios bajos, cuando vienen los precios altos, no aprovechemos la oportunidad y seguimos en ese círculo vicioso negativo para la agricultura. Y pensando en fórmulas, vinimos a hablar de mecanización y se está hablando de semillas, como pensando en fórmulas, más irrigación, más fertilización, más mecanización y ahora le agregamos storage. Todo eso combinado que nos lleva a pensar en lo que yo creo que es bien fundamental, la pregunta que nos hicieron ahorita, que es parte del énfasis que le queríamos dar al seminario de hoy, cómo jalonar a los pequeños y los medianos productores y que las empresas privadas no pueden hacer la tarea de proveer también servicios de financiamiento, el tema de la asociatividad. Entonces, el rol del Estado para integrar, para proveer y integrar estos servicios es fundamental. Y un tema recurrente es el tema de la escala de producción, ¿no? Y en la mañana decían un concepto que me gustó mucho, escalas de producción sin límites de cerca, o sea que no se necesita violentar los sistemas de propiedad ni también la pequeña propiedad, sino que hay formas de encontrar soluciones para aumentar la escala y organizar la demanda de mecanización. Eso como algunos temitas que se van a ir acumulando para más tarde y es un excelente momento para café, ¿no? Y nos vemos a las 3:15 exacto. Gracias.